Peter Donnelly left with the 14 minutes.
Deputy Donnelly, that's right.
That's it. Okay, so we've
seven minutes each.
Okay, first of all, I would like to, again, as others have, commend Deputy Collins for the huge work I know she and her team have put in to this bill. It's often said by the government, in a rather, I think, unfair and somewhat disingenuous way, that this side of the House is good at criticising but doesn't put forward alternatives. Now, I don't think that's true, and we have indeed on many issues put forward alternatives, but it is absolutely clear from this bill that huge effort has gone into producing a well-researched, well-thought-out alternative, and I hope that the government will seriously engage with the suggestions that are being made. And as has been underlined, Deputy Collins did not pull this out of her hat. She has researched it and looked at a comparable experience for Norway and a solution that worked over there. And I think, at the very, very least, the government has a responsibility to seriously engage with this, and even if they don't think that they agree with every single aspect of it, they should let this proceed to the next stage, so that we can seriously debate an issue which the government cannot claim they have got the last word on or the monopoly of wisdom on. You may say that the insolvency legislation will work, but it is absolutely clear that after 5 years of this crisis, an unprecedented crisis of mortgage distress, that that crisis is still with us, and that we need to look again at how we deal with it. And we need to be open, if we're serious, if we're being honest about dealing with this crisis that affects, in reality, about 180,000 families, 140,000 who are in distress, 40,000 or so who have been in restructuring arrangements, and actually tens of thousands of more who are just about making their mortgage payments but are screwed to the wall in the process, and who, if they are victims of further austerity measures, stealth taxes, cuts, social welfare cuts in the forthcoming budget, could find themselves going into arrears after the October budget, as indeed has happened in all of the previous budgets. So there is none more serious a crisis than this, and if this government is honest, even notwithstanding disagreements with this side of the House, ideological and the rest of it, if it's being fair, if it's being honest, and if it is open to a serious discussion about dealing with this most serious of crises, it will take this bill seriously and it will allow it to proceed for further discussion at the next stage. And, I mean, let's be clear, we are talking about a crisis of human suffering for all those families, of anxiety, in extreme cases of people taking their own lives. We are talking about a crisis that is having an extraordinarily damaging effect on the economy and its ability to recover. And we are talking about a crisis that is all the more galling and enraging for the people who are victims of it and for the people who are looking on at it, because it is one where the people who are at the sharp end of this crisis have not got bailed out, are not getting protected, but that the people who were responsible for this crisis have been bailed out to the tune of tens of billions, are protected at every hand's turn. Their bondholders are protected, the executives who made the decisions, who are still on astronomical salaries and expenses and so on, are protected, while tens of thousands of ordinary families are suffering, suffering the threat of the loss of their home, unable to pay their bills, having to make stark choices between putting the food on the table and paying off their mortgage at the end of the month. And it is surely, Minister, as it was very, very clear to all sides of this House, all sides of the political spectrum at the Finance Committee, when all of those banks came in, is that the bank's agenda is just their balance sheets. That's their agenda. That's what they're doing. In the case of the bank that is, if you like, least under state influence, because we're now only minority shareholders, the frankly contemptuous attitude of that bank towards the government's pleas, the public's pleas for write-down, for fairness and so on, they just didn't give a hoot. It's about the balance sheet, it's about the shareholders, that's all they care about. Some of the banks that are nationalised verbally sound a little bit different, but in reality are behaving in the same way. And of course, these banks are giving, the bailed out banks that we put money into, are giving write downs to some people. They are absorbing the money that we put in to bail out ordinary householders to give write-offs to the corporate debtors. And one extraordinary example that I never got an answer, I've raised it three or four times in here. I mean, how is it that Anglo-Irish Bank wrote off €110 million worth of debt for the company Sierra, owned now by Dennis O'Brien, who've now got the contract for water meters? They can get €110 million written off, but people who are struggling to keep a roof over their head, we are told by the banks absolutely blankly at the Finance Committee, we don't do write-down. We just don't do it. But they do it for some, and this is allowed. And I mean, the sort of schizophrenia of the banks is extraordinary. I mean, I still heard them trotting out the line at the committees where they were saying, we lent the money in good faith. That's money that's owed. We have the right to get it back. And as if those banks somehow were separate entities from the ones that were lending hundreds of millions to the developers, the profit-driven developers who pumped up the market in the first place and forced people into a situation of borrowing way over their heads just because they wanted to put a roof over their head. And the banks pretend as if these two activities were somehow separate from one another.
1 minute remaining.
So what we are asking very simply is to shift the balance. Shift the balance. As Deputy Collins has said, some of us would go a lot further in how we would deal with this. But this is a modest proposal to shift the balance, to force the banks to take some hit and to ensure the protection of people's family homes. And I would put it to you, Minister, that it is a test for the government. Are you listening? Are you listening to the people? Are you listening to the opposition? Are you willing to have a debate? We're willing to have a debate with you. We know there's questions about how this can be paid for and so on. But don't bat us off with sound bites. Have a discussion with us about, is it possible for the banks to give some write-down in a way that makes mortgages sustainable for people and protects their homes? Let's discuss the detail of that. Can it be done? Don't just dismiss it and don't just vote it down because it wasn't your idea. I appeal to you, Minister.
Thank you, Deputy.
And now, Deputy Stephen Donnelly. 7 minutes.